Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it on the lake. While all the people were along the shore at the water's edge, he taught them many things by parables, and in his teaching said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so they did not bear grain. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times. Then Jesus said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Mark 4, 1 through 9.
A powerful story, a powerful parable told in a really creative way. I'm so thankful for our production team, our video team, to be able to take that passage and kind of show us visually what Jesus might have been hinting at, direct about. And in some ways, putting it in a modern context with a video gives us some of that imagery to start to wrap our minds and our hearts around it. We're going to talk more about that parable, and we're going to jump into scripture even more to hear the interpretation of that. But before we do, I got to tell you a story. And before I tell you a story, I got to make sure you know who I am. My name is Woody Morwood. I'm one of the campus pastors here at Hillside Community Church, and I am so excited about what God's word has been doing in me and what I believe God's word wants to do in you today. Here's another story that I think will open some things up for us. 2010. I'm in Costa Rica with my family. My kids are on the younger end. We're there in a city and we're partnering with a missions organization to do a day with them to watch out for local kids that are living on the street that don't know about Jesus. And while we're there, we just have an amazing time seeing God at work in that country. The evening, we go to dinner and we walk into a restaurant and I know there's a buzz about the city. I don't know what it is. The TV screens turn on, the game comes on. That's right, the game. And all of a sudden, you can hear an entire city come alive. I think every person in that entire city either had a radio on or a TV on because it was FIFA World Cup soccer time. Or better yet, in Europe and other places in South America, it was football, right? The real football. It was so invasive. It was so overwhelming. Every time a goal was scored, I think everybody's windows were wide open and the whole city would go, "Goal!" From then on, the color red, soccer, chants, every time a World Cup comes up, that experience changed everything. I remember going to bed that night. South Africa is where the World Cup was in, so the time change was different. Remember trying to get quiet in our room so our kids and I could go to sleep, put a pillow over your head, try to create white noise of any kind to try to do it. That soccer game, that sport shaped everything. In some ways, a second story, just like the first story, the parable, helps get to the point of what I think God and Jesus want to shape in us today. Mark chapter 4, if you got a Bible, open it up, and I want to give you the first little bit of an intro that we find in there. The parable is told first, verses 1 through 9. Jesus was in a much drier climate than that video showed. He was on a boat because the crowd was pressing in, and he was teaching. If you have your Bible open in that verse 1, the word is again. Jesus was teaching, was reaching out, was trying to make sure everybody would know the good news of God. You see, this is a kingdom parable. If you look at Matthew, Mark, and Luke, there's a wide range of different parables. There are grace parables, kingdom parables, there are judgment parables. But the kingdom parables are about the reign, the rule, and the work of God here on earth. And it's happening all the time. There's a really interesting word, goes out. When in verse 1 it says a farmer goes out, verse 3, those first three verses imply this intentionality. If you go to Mark chapter 1, verse 38, and look there too, there was a moment when Jesus was in one town and they weren't real interested. They didn't want to hear. They didn't want to listen. They didn't believe there was life-changing information. And the verse 38 there says that Jesus went out, went on to another city. This parable has much of the same imagery, and there's a couple different words that set us up to be ready for what we need to do to enter into the story. What we need to do to be ready to maybe respond. And there's this word in verse 3 that comes up, and the word is listen. In Mark, listen comes up 10 different times. In fact, in this first telling of the parable, verses 3 through 9, the word listen and the word hear or listen, he who has ears to hear, is at the beginning and at the end of this parable. I don't know where you're at right now. I don't know if you're watching at home or watching on your phone, watching on a TV, listening to it as you're driving. I want to beg you to begin to posture your heart and your life in a listening posture, to be ready for what God might point out, maybe what God wants to do, to be ready to listen. You see, we're going to have a chance to really do a soil check. That's what I would describe this parable. It's what helps make sense to me is this is a soil check moment. This parable is told in both Luke and Matthew as well. And some traditionally often will look at this parable as kind of a story, a metaphor, a way for us to imagine ourselves as either saved or not saved. But the way that it happens in the gospel according to Mark is kind of like there are a wide range of moments and seasons and times where maybe our heart, our lives are a different kind of soil at every moment, and God is wanting to do something new to make us more like his children and more like his disciples. There's an author by the name of Marianne Tolbert that's really influenced me in my thinking around this parable out of Mark. And in her book, Sowing the Seed, she actually categorizes each of these soils with a group of people that are in the book of Mark. And today what I want to do is kind of work through each of those and really prepare our hearts to be ready to take communion today. If you didn't hear it up front, we're hoping that you will basically get ready for a sacred moment, that you would find some everyday normal items like bread, cracker, water, or juice, and be ready to receive those as a sacred, awe-inspiring moment that reminds us of what Jesus does in our life. We'll talk about each of the parables for each of the soils for a little bit, and then we'll open up a space for reflection and a song. And what I'm hoping is that you will have ears to hear, that I will have ears to hear and listen, and that with the season we find ourselves in, we can become, not out of our own efforts, but out of the efforts of what God wants to do in us, and we simply receive and receptive to what God wants to do, that a good soil can be worked in us and through us to create a harvest beyond anything we could ever imagine. If you still have your Bibles open or a tablet open or something like that, you will find in chapter 4, after Jesus told the parable to the large crowd from a boat, he has a private moment with the disciples. And in that private moment, he's going to be interpreting that. And the first soil that Jesus wants to interpret or take a look at is Mark 4, verse 15. Here's what it says. Some people are like seed along the path where the word is sown, and as soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in them. This seed fell on the pathway. You could imagine carts going over this. You could imagine Roman soldiers going over this. You can imagine people walking all the time on it. There were probably ruts in it. This seed does not stand a chance there. And some of you might like, well, why waste the seed? I'm thinking of kindergarten when you take one seed and you put it in the row. Take the second seed, put it in the row because you want one plant for every single seed that comes up in there. Well, you see, the gospel is a little different than that. The kingdom of God and what God is up to, the farmer and what Jesus, the seed, is trying to do in each of our lives. I didn't mention it in the upfront portion, but if you take your Bible and you look back a couple of verses, you're going to see the word scattered. Chapter 4, verse 4. And when this scattering happens, it is generous. Imagine Jesus's hands, or imagine a farmer's hands going into a whole bag of seeds and just flinging it. It doesn't discriminate. It isn't like kind of like greedy and careful and just make sure where they guaranteed it's going to grow. They are scattering it everywhere. And the first soil that Jesus tells us about is some of that in this massive scattering falls along the path. Marianne Tolbert takes the Pharisees, the scribes, those that work in the synagogue, the temple, those that are a part of Jerusalem that have hardened hearts. They are a lot like this hardened path. They know how they want God to work. They are firm in what is true and how things should be. And part of me wants to like put myself in the story and see if there's any type of soil like that in me. And probably the best way I could describe that for you is this. A couple hundred years before this moment, the Pharisees are the Pharisees for a reason. You see, there in Jerusalem, you have these other big nations. You have these other cultural influences coming in. You had the Greeks come first, the Romans come second. And when they came in, they didn't just want to conquer. They wanted everyone to think like them. They wanted the Jews, the Israelites, to let go of all their beliefs in God. And the Pharisees kind of grew up in that, trying to hold on to truth. Here's what's crazy about this first soil. They probably had right-hearted intentions to begin with. They were trying to do everything right. They were trying to keep God the focus of everything. But pretty soon, what became their focus was their focus. They were more interested in what they thought God should do. They were more interested in what their synagogue should do. They were more interested that they missed Jesus right there amongst them. This first soil scares me a lot, and I want to be so open to where God would point this out and change me, because these Pharisees walked with Jesus. They heard Jesus tell this story. They journeyed and saw miracles and still found a way not to buy in or to not listen, to cover their eyes, to cover their ears, and to have hard hearts. If you have your Bibles or write down some of these verses, look at Mark chapter 2, verse 15. Look at verse 18, verse 24. Look at Mark chapter 3, verse 6. Mark chapter 8, verse 11. I wrote down some of the posture and the heart of the Pharisees because they weren't receptive. They weren't anticipating. They weren't looking. They were arguing. They had high expectations. They were judgmental. They were know-it-alls. They were skeptical. They were whispering. They were saying, that's not possible, or that is not how we know God to work. And they were missing out on what God wanted to do. This first soil, the pathway, really is the way of the Pharisee. And in this season that we're all navigating, trying to figure out COVID-19 and what one church does and what another church does, or trying to make decisions with the state and the government and everything else, this is a real difficult time where sometimes the posture of my heart, your heart, or all of our hearts may be that we may feel like we know how God should work and the way things should be. And really, we're missing out on new ways that God wants to work in the middle of a really complex time. These are complicated days, and God wants to work, but we need to watch our hardened hearts. One of the things I want us to do as we prepare for communion at the end of our gathering is I want us to have a reflective moment three different times so that we can give God permission to point out any of this type of spirit. We don't want Satan to come in or the birds to come in and steal away what God intended. And what I'm going to have our team do here, I got Smitty and Harmony and Russell, and they're just going to sing a 50-second chorus. Some of you might close your eyes. Some of you might keep your eyes open to look at the lyrics, and I'll mention those here in a second. But I want this to be a moment where you might simply say, God, is the way of the Pharisees, or the heart of hard-hearted of the Pharisees, scribes in Jerusalem, is any of that in me right now? Am I a know-it-all? Am I trying to push people to do it my way? God, point out in me what needs to be made right and true? Take some time to reflect on this for a second.
Here's my heart, Lord, and here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, and here's my life, Lord. And here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true.
That song is going to be a declaration for us throughout this entire time in this parable. In fact, part of me wonders if you would be willing right now to even say those lines out loud or whisper them, or maybe even type them into the chat. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. This is a moment for us to be open and listening and ready for that seed that is scattered everywhere and maybe scattered in every arena of our lives. And I'm hoping as we go through each of these soils, God can do a new and great harvest in you and in me in this season. The second soil, if you have your Bibles or your tablets, is in verse 16 of that chapter 4. Remember, this isn't the first telling of the parable. This is the second time when Jesus is interpreting it just for his disciples in kind of a small one-on-one basis. And verses 16 and 17 describe the rocky soil or the shallow soil. And it says this, others, like seed sown on rocky places, hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The second soil is based on a group of people that can be found in a wide range of spots throughout Mark. And one of the most precise ones is right after this story is told at the end of chapter 4. If you look at verse 35, it's Jesus calms the storm. In this portion of Mark, Jesus is often getting in a boat and going to the other side of the lake, back and forth across the Sea of Galilee. It kind of creates these transition moments. And in one of those transition moments, the disciples are with Jesus and a large storm comes up. The second group, the shallow soil, because there's so many rocks, get excited and believe in Jesus, are ready to leave everything immediately. Remember that language is in Mark, the word immediately. They left everything and immediately followed Jesus. They hear this parable. They hear the parable interpreted. And then they're on a boat going across the ocean and all of a sudden a storm comes up. All of a sudden their focus that was on Jesus is now to the wind and the waves. Their focus of ready to follow the Messiah, the Son of God, that trusting amount of faith actually gets focused in on fear. And in the middle of this moment, Jesus, the one who can do everything, looks at the wind, the clouds, the storm, and says, quiet, be still. And then Jesus looks at his disciples and says, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? The second soil of the rocky ground is one that I've had to really wrestle and think through the last couple months because I feel like fear is my neighbor. I feel like fear is in the backpack I wear daily. I get an update about the CDC or a favorite place closing down or a friend who's lost a job and needs to move to another state to be able to afford things. There's so much storm and waves that wants to take my attention. And Jesus, in this space, in Mark, was saying, keep your focus on me. I think about Sunday morning sermons. I think about stuff that I've gone to almost my entire life. And you hear a great word on a Sunday morning, you're like, yes, that's going to change my life. And by Monday morning, we've forgotten it and moved on. The second soil, the rocky soil, is shallow. And the word comes in because it's sown generously and scattered everywhere, often grows up quickly, and then the heat of the day, the fears, the anxieties, the storms, and the worries, much like the early disciples before they became mature, end up dying. I want you to take 50 seconds again here. I want you to hear this chorus sung over you. I want you to be ready to be able to point out to God where maybe your eyes have moved to fear instead of trust. And use this as a prayerful space as you hear these words sung over you again.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my life. Here's my
Maybe whisper that. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. Maybe declare that in the chats, wherever you're at. Have that be the posture of your heart as we continue to look at each of these soils. Okay, because I've discovered in my own heart, in my own life, as I look at this Mark passage, sometimes I'm layered like an onion. Sometimes there's so many complexities to everything I have going on in my life that there can be the way of the Pharisees in one area of my life. There could be the way of the immature young disciples in other areas of my life. And in this third one, there could be the way of a thorny soil. In the Mark, you'll find someone by the name of Herod. And Herod may be the one that fits this best, or even the rich young ruler. Listen to this thorny soil interpreted by Jesus in Mark 4, verses 18 through 19. It says this: still others, like seed among thorns, hear the word, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. The word Herod, the name Herod, was known by everybody in that space and time. When Jesus was born, there was a Herod who probably hired and had more people working on building projects than anybody else at that time in that area. Herod was large and in charge. Everybody knew this name. There was another Herod after him that was around for when Jesus would be crucified. And the name comes up around a story around John the Baptist. If you turn to chapter 6, verses 14 through 29, there is a moment where Herod, the second one, is having a grand party. You'd probably think of Selling Sunset or Keep Up with the Kardashians or maybe even really old school lifestyles of the rich and famous. This person had it all. But they had been following John the Baptist. Herod had been curious about the gospel message, but Herod had something going on in his life. He was having an affair with his brother Philip's wife, Herodias. And in that affair, John the Baptist knew it, and he would call it out in public. And John the Baptist would say, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is near." And in this chapter 6, verses 14 to 29, it tells us that Herod was in awe, was curious, was interested. But in this party, Herodias' daughter did a dance. And the dance was so impressive that Herod said, "Wow, ask for whatever you want and I'll give it to you." And she simply asked for the head of Herod on a platter. And you see Herod all of a sudden caving to the opinion of friends, going with the flow, keeping the look up that he needed to posture about being large and in charge. Here's another story. The rich young ruler in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31. There's a heartbreaking moment because Jesus basically says, come follow me. In another way, you know what Jesus might be saying? She's like, pay attention. This is the key to life. It's me. Come follow me. And the story tells us there in Mark that the rich young ruler dropped his head in sadness because he was of great wealth and he wasn't ready to do anything different. In this season that we're all navigating right now, trying to figure out finances and holding and keeping jobs or losing jobs or preparing for safety or worst case scenarios, the worries and the concerns of this world can really, really be thorny ground. To get distracted by the news, to let the things of culture shape us and decide for us what's important and what's not important, can really choke out the massive, generous scattering of the seed in our lives. I was talking about some of these themes with some team members that I get to meet with on Monday and Thursday morning, and in the process of talking about living boldly, living intentionally, one of the team members put this quote by C.S. Lewis out of Mere Christianity in the side chat, and it really struck me as kind of some of what each of us navigate and deal with every morning, even when we wake up. It says this, it comes the very moment you wake up each morning. All your wishes and hopes for the day rush at you like wild animals. And the first job each morning consists simply in shoving them all back. In listening to that other voice, taking that other point of view, letting that other larger, stronger, quieter life come flowing in, and so on all day. Standing back from all your natural fussings and feelings coming in and out of the wind. What C.S. Lewis is talking about is the voice and the kingdom and God. And what Jesus wants to do to give us real life, even in really complicated, difficult times, even in all the different arenas of our lives, our minds, our hearts, our souls, that in this moment, the way of Herod, the way of the rich young ruler, the thorny ground is not the way of Jesus either. I'd love for you to take another 40 seconds to just really hear this song sung over you. For you to open up and say, God, point out in me where there is no fertile soil. Point out in me what needs to change, what I need to confess so that I am more like you. Allow the song to be sung over you again as you reflect and ultimately prepare for communion and Jesus. Again, maybe whisper that. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. We've looked at three soils, and all of them are probably more focused on fear rather than faith. The controlling Pharisees, the strongly opinionated ones that really almost want to tell God how to God should be doing things. You got the second soil, the young, immature disciples who want to put their hands back on the wheel, want to take control when the storms and the worries come. And then that third soil, the soil of thorns, the worries of the world, the way of Herod, the way of the rich young ruler. We have this final and fourth soil that is so powerful that I've been reflecting on and thinking about, and really I'm so excited to share with you today. And it's Mark chapter 4, verse 20 is the interpretation that Jesus gives. Others, like seed sown on good soil, hear, receive the word, accept it, and produce a crop 30, 60, or even 100 times what was sown. This is the good soil. This is the soil that's prepared, wanting, desiring God in so many different ways. But I want you to be really careful here, because you don't have to do a lot of work to be ready for this. You don't have to like pull yourself up by the bootstraps. You don't have to be the one that finds a way for God to do, and you just have to receive in the most simple way. In fact, let me give you a group of people out of Mark that did this well, that models this for us. This week, if you had any time, I'd encourage you to read Mark chapter 5. There are three different healing stories in Mark chapter 5, and each of them have a little portion that just shows a seed of faith, a small mustard seed welcoming the kingdom. The first one is in Mark chapter 5 and begins with verse 1, and it's about the man who is demon-possessed by so many demons, lives amongst the tombs, lives in a graveyard. Death is his best friend. And it says in verse 6 something really powerful. It says, when he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and fell on his knees in front of Jesus. The way this story goes, it's almost like, yes, there's evil involved here, there's demons, there's chaos, but in a moment of humanness, a moment of recognition of what this person needs for life to change, he sees Jesus off in a distance and goes to him. A small bit of faith, and Jesus casts out these demons into a herd of pigs, and this man's life is changed forever and goes and tells everybody. It's kind of crazy that in this moment, a small act of trust and belief in Jesus changes everything. The second story is about a woman who is bleeding all the time, and death is just on the doorstep, and pain and discomfort. And there's a powerful verse in verse 27 that simply says this: when she heard about Jesus, she went to go find him in a large crowd and just touched the hem of his robe. It doesn't say she got everything figured out, she was a firm belief, she had all the details, she was 1,000% confident. It simply says when she heard about Jesus, she was receptive, she was ready, and she was healed. There's a third story, and this third one is powerful as well, because it's about a man by the name of Jairus, and he was a ruler in the synagogue, which is really interesting, because remember those Pharisees, that first soil? It looks like there's an opportunity that this person became more receptive, that was willing to lean in instead of the old hardened heart that maybe many of his colleagues and friends may have had. His daughter was sick. He went to Jesus and said, please come heal her. Jesus got there, some would say late, and others would say just on time. And Jesus heals Jairus' daughter. And a little bit of faith, a willingness to step out, and everything changes. I've mentioned the way of the Pharisees. I've mentioned the way of the early, young, immature disciples. I've mentioned the way of Herod and the rich young ruler. I want to mention the way of the dependent. Those who keep their eyes on Jesus, who choose faith, even if it's just a little tiny bit, over fear. Those first three soils are a lot like my heart, your heart, and all of our hearts at different moments and different seasons. We want to focus on ourselves. We want to take control. And what we've been preparing for today is communion. And what we've really been preparing for today is to receive Jesus once again. This story of the scattered seed was lived out in my home this week in a powerful way that had an absolute, just life-changing impact on me. My son, 21 years old, lost his job at the beginning of the summer because of COVID-19. They didn't need that role anymore. They were trying to save money. And he's been looking for a job the last couple of months, interviewing 3 or 4 places. But on this particular Friday, we had some workers at our house. And because one of the workers' daughter couldn't go to kindergarten, he brought his daughter to our house to do a job. walked in the house and the daughter hung out with us all day long. And when my son got ready to get on an interview virtually, this little girl was sitting there watching my wife. And when my wife said, "Ryan, can we pray for you?" My wife prayed this little faith prayer, this good harvest, this good soil prayer of, "God, we haven't found a job yet. We don't know when a job's gonna come up. Would you be with Ryan? Would you watch out for Ryan in this moment?" And I opened up my eyes and I watched this little kindergarten girl look up with the biggest eyes ever. And I imagined the seed being scattered of what it means for Jesus to change the hearts and lives of little ones. Like a little child, she was being changed. Ryan was being changed. And after that moment, this young girl said to my wife, "I was in Home Depot with my dad and I saw one of the big, giant, scary skeletons for Halloween. And I want to pray at night so I could go to sleep that Jesus would change everything." Friends, the seed has been scattered. And the question today will be simply this: do we have ears to hear? Will we listen? Will we focus on Jesus? If you have the communion elements that you prepared, I would love to walk us through communion. And I'd love to do a simple thanksgiving prayer first before I walk through this, because Jesus often thanked the Father for what was right in front of him. God, I thank you for this salvation meal. I thank you for this ongoing remembrance of what you've done for us. Would you find in us a good soil? Would you forgive us for all the other soils that distract us and help us camp out and live in fear? God, I pray that this would be a life-changing moment for everyone. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says that Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, I almost feel like Jesus was still scattering seeds. On the night that he was betrayed, said to the disciples, a whole conversation of what he was getting ready to do. I'd love to tell you, if you are a Christ follower, if you've asked for forgiveness, if you are a disciple, this meal's for you. And if you haven't done that, it's really simple. All you have to do is say, "God, I'm a sinner, forgive me. God, I want you to be my focus and I want to be a good soil. Help me listen and be receptive." And you can take this meal with us. In 1 Corinthians, Jesus took the bread. And the Apostle Paul reminds us of everything he did. He took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body broken for you." Broken so we can hear, so we can listen, so we can become good soil. And the Apostle Paul reminds us that Jesus said, "Take and eat." And I'd love to encourage you right now, wherever you're at, to take and eat the broken body of Christ. After breaking the bread, Jesus took the cup and passed around to the disciples and he said, "This is my blood, which is spilt for you. Take and drink." Lord, thank you for speaking what is true. Thank you for forgiving those postures and places in our hearts where we are not a good soil. Lord, I pray that this week when we hear numbers about COVID, when we worry about finances, when our faith is really, really short and we go back to being in control and wanting our hands on the wheel, God, would you help us say these lines and trust you? Here's my heart. Here's my life. Speak what is true. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for hope. Thank you for a way to live through today, tomorrow, and for all eternity with you. In Jesus' name, amen.